Hello, I'm Akinori Hosoyamada from NTT and Nagoya University. This is a token tied to quantum security of HMAC and NMAC in the quantum random oracle model. This is a joint work with my supervisor, Tetsu Iwata. So first, I'd like to explain about background and summary of our results. In cryptology, message authentication code, or MAC, is one of the most basic and important primitive. And there exist several types of practical MACs. For example, there exist block cipher-based MACs, such as CBC MAC and PMAC, and there also exist the combination of Wegman-Carter construction and polynomial hashes, such as GMAC and Poly1305, and so on. And another construction is hash-based MACs, such as HMAC and NMAC, and Kiegel-Sponge construction, and so on. And our focus is HMAC and NMAC. And HMAC, or hash-based MAC, looks like this. This is the most basic approach to convert Markov-Dangard hash function into MACs. And it is standardized in FIPS and used in many applications, such as TLS and SSH and IPsec and so on. And so, in HMAC, first, a secret key K is chosen uniformly at random. And two keys, K-in and K-out, are computed like this. Here, IPAT and OPAT are some fixed constants. And for each input M, the M is concatenated with the first message, first key K in, and processed with the Markov-Dangard hash function like this. And then this output is concatenated with the second key K out, and again processed with the Markov-Dangard hash function. So, for each message, the Markov-Dangard hash function is evaluated twice. This is HMAC, and NMAC looks like this. This is a two-key variant of HMAC, and in this construction, two independent keys, K1 and K2, are chosen uniformly at random and used like this. HMAC and NMAC are proposed by Berari et al. And next, in the classical setting, the security of HMAC and NMAC is well studied, and in the classical setting, the tight security bound is 2 to the power n over 2. That is, HMAC and NMAC are indistinguishable from a random function up to 2 to the power n over 2 classical queries. And in the quantum setting, Song and Yun proved that HMAC and NMAC are secure up to 2 to the power n over 5 or 2 to the power n over 8 quantum queries. And on the other hand, there exists a trivial attack that distinguishes HMAC and NMAC from a random function by using 2 to the power n over 3 quantum queries. And actually, there still exists a gap between proven lower bound and the trivial upper bound. And in symmetric key cryptology, it is very important to study the tight bound of a symmetric key primitive for each symmetric key scheme. So, the natural question is, can we show the tight quantum security bound of HMAC and NMAC in the quantum setting? This is the starting point of our research. And we showed these results. We showed the tight quantum security bound of HMAC and NMAC in the quantum random oracle model, where the compression function H is a quantum random oracle. And we showed that HMAC and NMAC are indistinguishable from a random function against quantum query attacks as long as this inequality holds. Here, small qh is the maximum number of quantum queries to the compression function, and capital Q is the maximum number of quantum queries to the keyed oracle of HMAC and NMAC, and L is the maximum message length. And this bound is tight when L is not exponentially large. We used the compressed oracle technique to prove this bound. And in our proof, the hardest part is to prove the probability of a bad event is very low. And so, to prove this hardest part, we introduced a new idea to capture the uncertainty of outputs of a random function that the adversary cannot observe directly. So, this is the summary of our results. And next, I'd like to explain a rough overview of the proof. In our proof, we consider a sequence of games. And the first game, G0, looks like this. Here, the adversary is given a quantum oracle access to the quantum oracle of NMAC, and the quantum random oracle. And so here, this illustrates the case where the message is a one block message. And here, this one illustrates the input is two block message. And this one similarly illustrates the case where the input is three block message. And next, I would like to change this tilde function and this tilde function to two independent random functions, like this. And we call this game G1. And next, we change this composition F1 and F out into another random function G1. And we call this game G1 prime. And next, similarly, we change this composition F1 and H into another random function F2. And we call this game G2. And similarly, we change this composition F2 and F out into another random function G2. And we call this game G2 prime. And similarly, we define games G3, G3 prime, G4, G4 prime, and so on. And in the transition from GI to GI prime, we change the composition FY and F out into another random function GI. And in the transition from GI prime to GI plus 1, we change the composition of FY and H into another random function FY plus 1. And the final game, GL prime, is the ideal game where the construction oracle is the random function. And actually, this is the hardest part in our proof. I mean, the hardest part is to prove the indistinguishability of GI prime and GI plus 1. And so next, I'd like to explain about how we can prove the hardest part in the classical setting. The hardest part of the indistinguishability of those games can be simplified like this. So here, the adversary is given two oracles. The first one is this function, and the second one is the quantum random oracle. Or the first oracle is a random function f prime, or the second oracle is the quantum random oracle h. And the adversary's goal is to distinguish these two words. And next, actually, we can change this f prime like this. And here, the function g is another random function which takes three inputs, u and v and fu. And since g takes u and v as inputs, we can see that the distribution of this function is the same as distribution of this function. To show the indistinguishability of these functions, it is sufficient to show the indistinguishability of these functions. And in what follows, I will explain about how to show the indistinguishability of these functions instead of the original this one. And next. I call this function f1h and I call this function f2. And to show the indistinguishability of these functions very intuitively, they are indistinguishable if these bad events call and hit do not occur. Here, the first bad event call is the event that a new output of f, this value, collides with a previous input to h, that is, this value, a previous input here, or a previous value here. This is the first bad event call. And the second bad event hit is the event that a new direct query to h, this value, collides with a previous output of f, this value. And very intuitively, if these bad events do not occur, then the outputs of f1h and f2 seem completely random. So in the classical setting, what we have to prove is the probability of call and probability of hit are small. And this probability can easily be upper bounded by using the randomness of f, because this first bad event call happens only when a fresh value u is queried to this random function f. We can use the randomness of f to upper bound this probability. But for the probability of a second bad event, we cannot use the randomness of F directly, because the second bad event hit happens only if an adversary queries some value to the random oracle H. And we do not know what the adversary will query. And so even in the classical setting, some techniques are needed, such as coefficient H technique is used to deal with the second bad probability hit. And next, I'd like to explain about the compressed oracle technique. So in the classical setting, proofs often rely on the fact that queries and answers can be recorded. However, in the quantum setting, recording queries in naive ways disturb quantum states. And so lots of classical proofs are invalid in the quantum setting. But at Crypto 2019, Chandri showed a technique named compressed oracle technique, which enables us to record queries of random functions to some extent. This is a very useful technique, and we also use this technique. And next, the compressed oracle holds databases of queries and answers in quantum superposition. And the joint quantum states of the adversary and the oracle look like this. Here, this one corresponds to the state of the adversary, and this one corresponds to the state of the oracle, or the record of queries and answers. And the compressed oracle behaves like the classical lazy sampling to some extent. That is, when a fresh query X is made, then the uniform superposition of Y, this one, is added to the database. This is not strictly a correct explanation, but intuitively, the compressed oracle behaves like this. And the important point is, sometimes records are forgotten or overwritten. This is very different from classical lazy sampling, but this property is essential not to disturb quantum states. And next, I'd like to explain about the proof in the quantum setting. So the first proof idea to show the indistinguishability is to combine the classical proof idea that I mentioned before and the compressed oracle. And very intuitively, the joint quantum states of the adversary A and the oracle F1, H, and H, and the joint quantum states of the adversary A and the oracle F2, these quantum states will be indistinguishable as long as the bad events, call and hit, do not happen in the databases and for adversary's query. And so, again, what we have to prove is that very intuitively, the probability of call event and the probability of hit event are small. Actually, the terminology probability is not necessarily correct in the quantum setting. But for simplicity and for intuitive explanation, I use the word probability even in the quantum setting. And next, again, this probability can easily be upper bounded by using the randomness of F, because the compressed oracle behaves like the lazy sampling. But for the probability of the second bad event hit, the randomness of F cannot be directly used. And again, as I mentioned before, this bad event hit happens only when the adversary queries some value to the quantum random oracle, and we do not know what the adversary will query. In addition, in the quantum setting, we cannot use classical proof techniques such as coefficient H, because they assume that the classical techniques often assume that queries and records can be recorded. And so here, a new technique is needed to deal with the bad event hit. And here, first, I'd like to remark that the second bad event hit is the event that the adversary A succeeds to guess an output of the random function F. And next, so suppose that there is an adversary A, and this is given quantum query, quantum oracle access to F1H, and the quantum random oracle H. And this function F1H looks like this. And suppose that the adversary A makes a fresh query U and V to F1H. Then first, this value fu is sampled, and let me denote this value by alpha. Then the database for f is updated like this. And next, this value v and alpha is queried to h. And the value w is sampled and returned to the adversary. And the database for h is updated like this. And next, the adversary a tries to guess this value. And suppose that the adversary's guess is z. Then the important point is the adversary knows w but does not know anything about fu or alpha. And so these databases are indistinguishable for adversary. Here, these databases are different from the first database only by the value of fu. I mean, if these values u and v and w are consistent, then even if the output of f are different, the adversary A cannot notice. I mean, these databases are indistinguishable as long as U and V and W are consistent, even if the output of F are different. And so, based on this intuition, we see databases are equivalent if they are indistinguishable from the adversary. And for arbitrary z, the probability that z is indeed an output of f, I mean, the probability that the adversary succeeds to guess this value, this probability is equal to this ratio, the number of equivalent databases such that fu is indeed equal to z for some u, over the number of all equivalent databases. And we can show that this ratio is equal to order I over 2 to the power n after making I queries. And this means that the probability that the bad event hit occurs at the ith query is equal to order I over 2 to the power n. And next, let phi hit denotes the vector that corresponds to the bad event hit happens after making q queries. And let phi I hit denote the vector that corresponds to the event that hit happens at the ith query. Then the norm of this first vector can be upper bounded like the sum of the norm of phi I hit. And in the previous slide, we essentially and this norm of this vector is equal to the square root of this probability. And in the previous slide, I showed that this probability can be upper bounded like this. And so eventually, we obtain this upper bound, order the square root of 2 to the 3 over 2 to the power n. And this means that the norm of phi hit is very small as long as the number of queries is less than 2 to the power n over 3. And very intuitively, this norm is equal to the square root of bad event, bad probability hit. So this also means that the bad probability hit probability is very small as long as q is less than 2 to the power n over 3. And so more precisely, we show phi hit, the normal of phi hit is very small as long as the number of queries is less than 2 to the power n over 3. And similarly, we also show that the norm of the vector that corresponds to the first bad event call is very small as long as the number of queries is less than 2 to the power n over 3. And we also show the quantum states for f1h and the quantum state for f2 are equal, or there exists an isometry if these bad events do not happen. And we also show the quantum coefficients for equivalent databases are exactly equal. And we show these claims by tracing coefficient, quantum coefficient of each vector in detail. And so, recall that we consider these, this sequence of games. And we showed that these games, gi prime and gi plus 1, were indistinguishable up to 2 to the power n over 3 queries. And we can also show these lemmas are indistinguishable up to 2 to the power n over 3 quantum queries similarly. And this means that these games, the UR game in Mac and GL prime, the IDL game, or random function, are indistinguishable up to 2 to the power in over 3 quantum queries when L is very small. And so, this is how we proved the tight quantum setting of NMAC. And the proof for HMAC is almost the same. So, finally, I'd like to provide the summary of today's my talk. We showed the tight quantum setting bound of HMAC NMAC in the quantum random oracle model, where the compression function H is a quantum random oracle. And we showed that HMAC and NMAC are indistinguishable from a random function against quantum query attacks as long as this inequality holds. And this inequality means that the tight bound of HMAC and NMAC, the tight quantum sensitivity of HMAC and NMAC is order 2 to the power n over 3 when L is not exponentially large. And to prove this bound, we used the compressed oracle technique. And the hardest part of our proof is to prove the adversary's success probability is very low. And to prove the hardest part, we introduced a new idea and equivalent databases to capture the uncertainty of outputs of a random function that the adversary cannot observe directly. That's all. Thank you for your attention.